Welcome, everybody. My name is Sultan Sooud Al Qassemi. I will be taking off my mask during this tour so you can hear me clearer. I am a visiting instructor at the Islamic Civilization and Societies program at Boston College. We are now standing at the McMullen Museum in Boston College, which is hosting an exhibition titled Taking Shape, Abstraction from the Arab World, 1950s to the 1980s. It is an exhibition in its second venue. The first venue was NYU Art Gallery earlier last year. And this exhibition lasts until early June 2021. The exhibition consists of around 90 abstract paintings hailing from 14 countries of the Arab world. And there are countries that are not represented. We apologize to that. However, we tried our best. This exhibition includes works, as I said, that were created between the 50s and the 1980s. And it consists of artists who have various backgrounds, Muslim, Christian, Jewish, Armenian, Amazigh, and many other minorities and backgrounds. This exhibition, as I said, consists of works from the second half of the 20th century. Why do we believe that the era of the 1950s, 60s, 70s, 80s is an interesting time? It is because it is a time of nation building across the Arab world. Most of the Arab states gained their independence in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. And there was a time of nation building and identity formation, a time in which government had commissioned major monuments as well as artworks, opened schools as well as universities. And many artists turned from figurative painting to abstract painting in that time. Why did they do that? It's because these artists were inspired due to mass migration, due to movement, due to the facilities of travel. They were inspired by artists from across the world, but they also tried to contextualize and localize the global art movement into a local movement. And they drew inspirations from their surroundings, including architecture, Islamic architecture, including calligraphy and other forms of inspiration. I would also like to say that this tour will highlight a number of works, perhaps 20 to 25 out of the 90. It's impossible to cover them in that period. But also you have a chance to take a deeper dive in a docent's tour. Every Friday afternoon, you could log on to the McMullen website and you will be able to sign up for the tour. You can also take your own tour, a virtual tour on the McMullen site, and you can zoom into every painting and read the labels. So that is available for you at your leisure. The last thing I will say is that even though we tried our best in this exhibition to draw works from many countries, and as I understand, this is the largest ever exhibition of abstract art from the Arab world, we really are missing a lot. And the reality is it is almost impossible to cover a region of 300 to 400 million people in an exhibition of 90 paintings. I can tell you there are several movements that are missing, such as the Awsham or tattoo movement of North Africa and Algeria, the Syrian modern abstract group of the 1960s, and the circulism movement that was formed in Kuwait in the 1950s and 60s. These are just three examples of movements that we are missing in this show. And so it's essential for you to understand as you go in this tour that this does not even begin to represent the entire region. However, this is perhaps a start to towards a conversation that needed to take place. Now we will begin the tour after some delay. Again, I wanted to repeat that this era was an era of identity politics, nation building, and independence. And many, and I think we are here in what I refer to as the Moroccan Hall of the McMullen Museum, and because all the works are drawn from that North African country. But I think I can take this country as an example of a very important movement that emerged in the mid-1960s called the Casablanca School. Now, the Casablanca School was a movement that was started by a number of artists such as Hamidi and Mohammed Mlehi, who saw that much of the art was being shown in Morocco in the 1950s and 60s to an elite audience. This art that was being shown in hotel venues and spaces that were not really accessible to the general public. And so what they did, ladies and gentlemen, they literally picked up their artworks and moved to Marrakesh, to Jami' al-Fna, the Fna Square, the very famous market, and they hung the works on the walls of the market. And so the passersby were able to admire and understand and take a closer look at these works. Another thing that is very important about the Casablanca School is that they drew inspiration from African, Amazigh, and Islamic heritage, as well as Arabic heritage. And what they did also was that they tried to contextualize the work to a local Moroccan environment. And so I will ask the individual holding the camera, by the way, who's Rachel Chamberlain from the McMullen, to come a bit closer to me, please. I would like to show you this work from 1983 by Farid Belkahia. If you zoom in a little bit, you will notice that this painting called Orb or Dawn is a work on vellum. So it's a pigment on vellum, which could be seen as a leather, animal skin, and what the artist tried to do is to draw inspiration from traditional crafts, including pigments, henna, and saffron. And this is the way, ladies and gentlemen, in which artists were trying to contextualize the work to a local environment. I have to lift it? Okay, thank you very much. Sorry about that. Work in progress. Okay, so as you see here, these are two magnificent works by a Moroccan artist called Mohamed Melehi. Melehi passed away just a few weeks ago, but as you see from his work, very much draws inspiration from Mediterranean colors and Atlantic colors. He was, of course, one of the founders of the Asila Festival in Morocco and one of the founders of the Casablanca School. Would you please follow me, Rachel, as I show you this work by one of the leading female artists, I think, of Morocco and North Africa, Malika Aghzni. This work, Blue Algae or Algae, from 1968, as you can see, it's a wood and acrylic on wood artwork. It's a relief piece that she draws, again, inspiration from organic forms, but also from Arabic calligraphy. Now, Malika was a student at the Casablanca School in the 1960s, and she was very much influenced by the teachers there, and also, especially, I think, by her teacher, Muhammad Shaba. This work, again, a piece created on wood, as you see, as we walk closer, was inspired by that massive piece over there by Muhammad Shaba, her teacher from the 1960s onwards. But I will be taking a right turn here and showing you one of my favorite works. I'm so happy that we have this painting by Ahmed Sharqawi, who passed away in the mid-1960s at a very, very young age. This work, however, looks quite abstract. It is an abstract work, but it has a lot of hidden meanings behind it. One of the meanings is that Ahmed Sharqawi, who was part Berber, part Arab, was inspired by the national movement, the nationalism movement, the movement of Amazigh rights of the 1950s and 60s. And this artwork here is drawn actually from the letter Yaz, which is an Amazigh letter. It also denotes free man, and it is the shape of the Amazigh nation flag. And so as you can see, these abstract artists are slowly or in a way inserting their national identity in artworks of the era in the 1960s. Would you please follow me, Rachel, as we go, as we leave the Moroccan room and move into the next hall. We'll be taking a right here. Again, it's very difficult for me to pick and choose which work to talk about. However, I had a special request from a very dear friend of mine to talk about this work by Dia Azari. So this is a work titled Composition from 1976. It is the year after he had moved to London. Dia Azawi, the very important modernist artist, and he had taken a political turn by the mid-1970s. He had left Iraq, moved to the UK, and very much inspired by Palestinian independence cause and many other political movements in the Arab world. As you see, this work seems to be at least inspired with hints of a human form. However, it is almost an abstract painting. I always think that these are little fingers. Maybe a little story I can share with you is that I got this work from Morocco. And so Dia Azawi was a constant traveler to North Africa, and this work was sold in Morocco in the 1970s. Please follow me, Rachel. Okay. Now, once again, it is very difficult to choose between these works, what to highlight and what not to highlight. I always feel that I might be missing out on an important artist. But yes, fine. Yes, I will talk about this work. I had a request from Deanna Larson, who works here at the McMullen Museum. So Deanna and everybody else, this is a work by Abdullah bin Antar, or Ben Antar, as the French called him. This is a work called Tout Monet, Giverny. Obviously, it is a work created about 25 years after the artist immigrated to France. And this is a work in which he references Monet's very famous artworks or series of works, the Jardin de Tuileries. And in this work, he also draws inspiration from Sufism as well. It's almost like it is a response by a North African artist. But I think this is an opportune time to talk about how many artists across the Arab world used landscape painting and abstracted landscape painting. So you could tell that this is a work that includes water, but it's completely abstracted. And a lot of people say that abstracting artworks is a way of making the work more approachable, more understandable, and less elite. This is not a work that's decorative. It is a work that's closer to the everyday person. Maybe I'll move here to this work on the right. This is an artwork by an Egyptian artist called Ramses Younan, who was living in France in the 1950s and moved back to Egypt. He actually is very important because in the 1930s, he was quite political. He was part of a group of artists known as the Art and Liberty Group. And this movement of artists had rejected the forces of evil that had emerged in Europe between the wars, whether it's fascism or Nazism, and issued a manifesto in solidarity with the Jews and other minorities of Europe who were being persecuted, especially in Germany and other countries. And so we see here his turn from figurative work into abstraction, almost drawing inspiration from the human mind. I understand he was very much influenced by psychology, to another form of inspiration that influenced artists from the Arab world. Moving on here, I'm very proud to say that we have quite a sizable representation of women artists. And I think this is a chance for me to talk about how, when we were building this exhibition, Rachel and Diana and Ivana as well, thank you so much for helping us and being here, it was a process of learning about abstraction in the Arab world. Initially, I did not know that women had played such a pioneering and leading role in abstraction in the Arab world. I think as we were thinking about this show in 2017, when I was at NYU, I approached the NYU art gallery. Lynn Gumpert was the director of that gallery when I was a practitioner in residence at the Kevorkian Center at NYU. And she proposed an exhibition of abstract art to me. And I thought to myself, interesting. I wonder if this is actually an interesting topic. It turns out that yes, there's so much to say and so little has been written about it. And one of the discoveries, for me at least, was again the important role that women had played. So you can't imagine abstraction in the Arab world without thinking of the work of Salwa Rauda Shukair in Lebanon, Sami Halabi in Palestine, or as you see here, Hind Nasser of Jordan. So this work from the 1970s, once again, keeping with the theme of landscape art, is an important painting called Ayla, dating back to 1975. Hind Nasser, ladies and gentlemen, was one of the 12 or so students of an important artist called Fakhr Nissa Zayd. Fakhr Nissa Zayd was born in Turkey, married an Iraqi, moved to France, and then to Jordan. And when she was in Jordan, she established a fine arts institute named after her. And Hind Nasser was amongst her dozen or so students. Although I do believe that this work probably dates back to just before the period of time in which she was trained by Fakhr Nissa Zayd. We move now to one of my favorite works, a work that I think about and daydream of constantly. Hold the mic up. Yeah. Sure. Okay, everybody. Is this better? Okay. when will the museum be opening up to the community? Well, that is an interesting question, and we're very fortunate here to have representatives from the institution. But what I understand is that the safety of everybody is paramount to Boston College and the McMullen. And so we will be following the orders from the state and the county, the city of Boston as well. And so we would very much like for it to be open. However, in the meantime, you could take advantage of the virtual tours and keep visiting the website. And of course, as soon as it does open to the public, I will blast it out on social media and inform all of you and hopefully come here and give you personal tours maybe one day. Otherwise, there's plenty to see online. So please do so. And you can do that from the safety of your own, your own home. Okay, so as I said, there were many causes or reasons of why abstract art emerged in the Arab world in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. One of them, of course, was calligraphy and Sufism. The Sufism, of course, for those who don't know, is a spiritual form of Islam. And many artists in this show follow the Sufi path, as we call it, including this wonderful artist behind us, Ibrahim Al-Salahi, who is considered to be one of the most important living artists anywhere in the world. Ibrahim Al-Salahi, a Sudanese artist who was born in 1930, today represented and collected by major museums from around the world. If you go to the Tate Modern, you see his work on permanent display. The Met had a work as well. There's the Newark Museum has a work on display. The Art Institute of Chicago has a work. And so he's become one of the most important artists, I think, of our age. Now, Ibrahim Salahi's story is fascinating because he went to the Gordon Memorial College in Khartoum before getting a scholarship and studying in the UK. When he came back from the UK, he mounted an exhibition, and the exhibition, again, he was trained by Europeans and Western art, and the exhibition he held in Khartoum, I believe it was in the late 1950s, was not received very well by the Sudanese because he had painted Western European landscapes. And so nobody identified with them. And so he then went on a journey of discovery of his roots and his culture and his identity. And he started creating works that were Sudanese, if you like, but at least they were inspired by many elements such as his faith, his continent, his country, his culture, his language. And I think this is one of his most important artworks. It's called The Last Sound. It's from 1964. In this work, ladies and gentlemen, he created it at the wake of following his father's passing on, and he heard about it and he wasn't able to attend, I believe, and so he created this work in which he references celestial objects in a way to denote the universality of humankind and the human spirit. You also see the circular shape here that references Sufism and the tariqa, the circular tariqa. People also say that this is form here is an African mask. There are also references, subtle references to letters as well as birds. Let me find you one of the birds. There you go. So this is one of the birds. And from what I understand from some Sudanese friends is that these are migratory birds that appear at specific seasons of Sudan. I think this is the spring season and then you have the autumn season. And so again, he's trying to reference the town of Omdurman through the colors. So these are the colors of the town of Omdurman. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, Rachel, if you can zoom up to this bit over here, you will see Islamic and Sufi prayers. This one, this is a prayer in which the prophet is being praised. And this one over here, Rachel, if you can just come a bit closer, it says, "Yatibu biha kullu al-wujudi wa yatala'ala." So I believe that with the referencing of God's name, that the world is a better place and the world is a sort of a more spiritual place. Let me move you down to this work by these three works by Shakir Hassan Al-Sa'id, who I can talk about for a long time because he is definitely one of my favorites. So Shakir Hassan Al-Sa'id was born in 1925, an Iraqi artist who was really part of every major 20th century movement of Iraq. So in 1951, he co-founded with Jawad Salim a movement called the Baghdad Modern Art Group that drew inspiration from heritage. So they said in this movement that we draw inspiration from 13th
century Iraqi art, Yahya al-Wasiti, but also 20th century art like Picasso. And so they say that we are the bridge from the 13th century to the 20th century. And they reference the universality of art, at least in their case. About 10 to 15 years later, he co-founds or found this group called the One Dimension. And the One Dimension group that you see works represented from here, I think the earliest one is from 1961, this one. And this One Dimension group, ladies and gentlemen, references the letter. So drawing inspiration from the heritage in the 1950s to drawing inspiration from the letter in the 1960s. So this work, for example, again, as you can see, his very special technique of puncturing works, burning works, scratching works is something that recurs in many of his artworks. But I also want to say that there is definitely a political context in this work. I have not had a chance to interview him, but this work, for example, from 1983, references an era in Iraq in which Iraq was at war with Iran. And so this war was actually claiming many lives. It was a national project. And this work, you might not be able to read it, but here it says Al-Muntasirun, the victorious. So I wonder if he was talking here about the political context that Iraq was going through. Al-Muntasirun, the victorious. And maybe you can go closer here and see the scratches that he does and sometimes the burning in some of his other works. Rachel, if you follow me to this work by an Egyptian artist, Omar al-Negdi, again, you know, one thing that I want to say here, I think this is an opportune time, is this exhibition was conceived in 2017. The curators, of course, are Lynn Dumpert of NYU Grey Art and Suhaila Takesh of the Barjeel Art Foundation in Sharjah. And so they conceived this exhibition. And so I feel like I'm a bit like of a fish out of water when it comes to this show. But one thing I can tell you is since 2017 till 2021, we have lost at least 6 or 7 artists who are represented in this show. Again, these are artists who are part of the modern era of the Middle East and West Asia and North Africa. And they were part of the movement, again, that established these art groups and established these art movements dating back 70 years. So they are well into their 90s. And one of the artists that we lost was Omar al-Negdi from Egypt. In this work, which is untitled from 1970, you see these elements or these strokes that look like the number one. And the number one, again, he's a Sufi artist. And he says in interviews, I was inspired by tasawwuf, Sufiization, I think is one of the translations. So there's two things to look out for here. Number one, the letter one denotes the monotheism of Islam. God, there's no God, but God, one God. And so one, 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 the repetition of number one is also a Sufi movement. Again, Sufis recite in repetition their prayers. So it's almost a spiritual movement of there is no God, but God, there's one, 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 one God. And the other thing is, this also looks like the letter A or Alif in Arabic, and Alif is the first letter of the Arabic language and the first letter of the name of God, Allah. So Allah, Alif, letter A. And so it's a very interesting work and so much hidden in this artwork when you think about it. We're going to move in here. Another artist, sadly, that we lost was Oget Kaland. Oget Kaland was born as Oget Al-Khouri. She was the daughter of the founding president of Lebanon, but that's not why she is interesting to us. She's interesting because we believe that she is one of the greatest artists of the 20th century and 21st centuries. She hailed from Lebanon, but she lived all over the world. This is part of her body parts series of works. As you can see, it's a bit naughty, it's a bit cheeky. I'm not sure if this is completely allowed to be shown to children, but you see that she has definitely drawn inspiration from the human body and again, from erotic sensuality that you can find. Another artist who also follows this school is Afaf Zureiq, who is an artist living now in the US. And I will show you this work, Human Form, which I misunderstood in the beginning, thinking it was a different body part, but I'm going to now show you where she brought this idea from. It actually comes from these closed fists and fingers. And this is where Human Form 1983 originates from. Rachel, if you follow me, I would like to show you a couple of other artworks here. From Algeria, we have Mohamed Khadda. Mohamed Khadda is one of the most important artists of North Africa. He, again, was not a signatory to the Awsham or tattoo group, but as you can see, he drew inspiration from what was happening, at least in North Africa at that time. He was an Amazigh artist, and here you see the Awsham or Washam in Arabic, the tattoo that appears on the bodies of women and men alike, almost abstracted into this beautiful green color form. And here at the lower piece, Rachel, he places it in what appears to be a village that you can see somewhere in North Africa. There's so many artists. I mean, Hamid Abdullah's Tamazzuq, Hamid Abdullah, an Egyptian artist who was living between Denmark and Paris, took a political stance in the 1970s against the Egyptian government. And many of his works, he references letters, such as in this work, the word is Tamazzuq, or being torn. And sometimes these words that he uses references political events of the Middle East, such as the defeat in 1967, or maybe a political movement that Sadat took, such as the recognition of Israel in the 1970s. Kamal Bulata is another artist we lost. I think I can talk about him a little bit here, because he is one of these artists who talks about writing his artworks or writing his paintings, because he considers himself as a calligraphic artist, but someone who was inspired, even though he was a Christian artist, he was inspired by Islamic geometry and Islamic architecture. And in this work titled "There Is No I But I," he subtly references the Islamic phrase "There is no God but God." And so again, it looks like it's a geometric shape, but there's definitely some kind of playfulness in this work. The last piece I will show you in this gallery before we move to the other gallery, and apologies to all the other artists, I feel like I need to represent more. This is a very sort of rare work by Madiha Umar. Now, Madiha Umar is just genuinely one of the most important artists of the 20th century in the Arab world. She was Iraqi Syrian, and she moved to the US in the late 1940s, where she held an exhibition in 1949 here in the US, in Washington, D.C., and another one at the San Francisco MoMA in 1951 or 52. Now, why is she important? Because she is founder or co-founder of a movement of art called Hurufism or Letterism. Why is that movement important, ladies and gentlemen? Because this is a movement in which the artist attempted to liberate the letters from the word. And the idea, I believe, is that many people who speak Arabic or even Urdu or Turkish or Farsi, Persian, that they, whenever they see a phrase, they try to read it. And so this group of artists wanted to liberate and free the letter from the word. Another thing they did also is try to secularize the Arabic language. And so there's two important things of why they tried to do this. Number one, the Arabic language was seen as the language of religion and Quran, and they tried to take it and secularize it and make it available to everybody. Even though many artists were Muslim, some were Christian, but again, they tried to make the letters more accessible. And the other thing is that in this era of nationalism and independence of Arab states, for them, reclaiming their Arab identity was very important. Some of them were occupied, of course, by Western forces. Some countries were under Ottoman rule until the early 20th century. And so Arabic letterism was an important way for artists to reclaim their identity, their Arab identity. And of course, it even went beyond the Arab world into Iran and Pakistan and other parts. Rachel, if you follow me here, I also want to say just a shout out to the great team here at the McMillan, who did this lovely little arabesque installation, which I did not know was going to happen. I'm going to step behind it now so that you can see. Okay, Rachel, if you follow me into, this is your idea, well done. You're the designer, well done. Can you come into the screen just so I can thank you for a second? Ladies and gentlemen, this is Diana Larson, who is deputy director of the of assistant director. One of two did a great job. Thank you so much for this lovely space and design that you have put together. Thank you so much. By the way, I'm also very conscientious of the fact that I'm not wearing my mask. And so I feel like there's something wrong, but Yes, follow me here into this room. Again, it's very difficult to pick and choose which works to highlight to you. One of my favorite works here, and believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, the first time I ever saw this work with my own eyes was just 2 or 3 weeks ago. And the reason is when we acquired this work, it was sent directly into restoration, and then it was sent straight to New York. But for some reason, we weren't able to display it. And so it's being shown for the first time ever in public here at the McMullen Museum. This is a work by an Iraqi artist called Mahmoud Sabri, who was very close to the Communist Party in Iraq and studied in the USSR in the 1950s and 60s. And he created a number of figurative works showing the execution and the martyrdom of Iraqi leaders of the Communist Party, intellectuals, socialists, leftists, communists, of course. But what you see here is his drift from figurative work of the 1950s and 60s to his abstract work of the 1970s. This is a work actually dating from 1970s, so it's early on in his abstract movement. Why is this interesting and important for us? Is because he created his own inspiration. A lot of times people assume that West Asian and North African and South Asian artists were inspired by Western art movements, but that is not true. Many of them, such as Mahmoud Sabri, created his own science-based research. And in this series, from his quantum realism works, we see this work called Water. Again, he came up with his own formula in which he tries to draw inspiration from science. And that's why you have this stunning work with all its colors. I think I'll begin first with this work, Rachel, before I move to the Salwa sculpture. This is a work by a Tunisian artist. Again, we have 14 countries here and many countries are missing, but Tunisia is represented by the sole work by Najib Belkhoja called Abstraction Number 45. And I also like to read the back of any of these artworks. This one says it was shown in London in the mid 1960s. So that was interesting. As you can see here, ladies and gentlemen, it definitely is inspired by the shape of the city, the Medina of Tunisia or Tunis. A lot of artists drew inspiration from geography and topography, in this case, a city itself. Coming close to this work here, of course, we have a flickering light. This light never flickered. I've been here every day. It's never flickered until now because they know that I'm here. Okay, or the light knows. So this is the largest ever sculpture, at least to date when we acquired it, by Salwa Rauda Shukair, ever to come to an auction. This is a work called Interform from the early 1960s. And it has an interesting story, but I'll tell you a little bit about Salwa Rauda Shukair, a Lebanese pioneer. Again, she's one of those artists that over the last 10 years has received a lot of attention, deservedly so, and she is in the permanent collection on permanent display at the Tate Modern, at the Met, and is in the collection of the Pompidou in Paris and many other museums. But she drew inspiration from Islamic geometry. And that's why you see her almost working with the sculpture and paintings as though she is creating new forms of geometry based on either Islamic letters or Islamic shapes and architecture. Of course, what's interesting about Salwa Rauda Shukair is that she envisioned her sculptures to be much, much larger, 20 feet high even. But then of course she couldn't afford it. She was a sole artist, whether female or male, working in the Middle East. You didn't have much backing, especially when you were not one of the artists who were creating works for the government, which she wasn't, of course. But I think I can show you, before we go to the other Salwa, a quick pit stop here to Hassan Sharif, Emirati artist. In this work, he references the yin and the yang. This artist studied in Byam Shaw School in the UK. He was a very important caricature artist. So he did a lot of political caricatures in the newspapers in Dubai. But in this work, he's completely gone abstract. And again, its inspiration definitely is from his own studies and his own research, as well as his time in the UK in the 1980s. If you follow me here, Rachel, how are we doing on time, by the way? Okay, so maybe I'll stop in 5 minutes and we can take some questions. Okay, so Salwa Rawda Shuqair created composition in yellow, as you can see with this work from 1962 to 65. So even though the date says 62 to 65, that means that she might have started the work and then revisited the work over this next period of three or four years. This composition in yellow, she saw it as a process of layering. So you can imagine that many artists think of an artwork and look at the work from above. So you can imagine it looking like a carpet and you're putting a layer on top of another. So here again, she's layered the different colors on top of each other, again, inspired by Islamic geometry. I think these two works, if you take a step back and try to get me in one frame with these two beautiful works by Sami Halabi, a Palestinian artist born in 1936. Sami Halabi in the 1960s took a tour of the Middle East and North Africa. She visited Egypt, Syria, and Turkey, and she was definitely inspired by Islamic architecture and Islamic forms and that she references in many of her artwork. So once again, these works are not inspired by sort of Western education, but more so by the designs that she saw visiting mosques, visiting the old Medina. And this work, brown cube and white cube, actually, when we acquired the work, and this is something you get from the collector, is that Sami Halabi gave me an entire essay and write up about this work. So why, how the process came about to create this work. So, moving on to one of my favorite works, which standing where you are now, it looks like just a white line on a black rectangle, but that is not the case. This is an artist from Kuwait called Jafar Islah. This work is called The Void. It dates back to 1967. He uses the idea of the trick of the eye, whereas you think this is just a black painting, and I'm sure on the screen it just looks black, but if you come closer, you'll be able to make out up to 20 colors that are layered in the background. There's blue, there's green, there's purple, there's red. There's so many different colors in the background of this work. And of course, Jafar Islah, again, was inspired not by Western minimalism and Western abstraction, but inspired by the kilim rugs of West Asia. You see kilim rugs that many of us grow in, whether you come from South Asia or West Asia, these kilim rugs again are on the floor. And even his artworks, he talks about how he imagines them as being seen from above. Moving on, and I think I will just end with these last two or three works here. This work is one of my favorites. It's by Egyptian modernist Minhat Helmi. Minhat Helmi, is my story with Minhat Helmi's work is quite interesting. I went on social media, I went on Twitter, and I posted a call and I said, I'm looking for modern women artists from the Arab world. Does anyone know of any that I'm not aware of? And this lovely woman replied to me on Twitter and said, when I lived in Cairo in the 1990s, there was a nice lady living the floor above me, and I used to meet her on the staircase, and I understand she was an artist, and this is the number of her daughter. And so I messaged the daughter, and she said, yes, my mother was an artist. They sent me the work, and turns out, ladies and gentlemen, that she was not only a good artist, she was a great artist. She was an artist that won first prize in the Slade School, where she studied in the 1950s. She represented Egypt in biennials in Europe and South America. And here in this work in 1973, she actually was thinking about the era of space exploration. This work has several titles. It's called The Universe or Space Exploration. And actually I have somewhere here the original name, and I think it was called Broadcast into the Universe or something. Quite an interesting title as well. Again, an abstract work by an artist who was unknown to us, but the process of discovery was very, very important. And I think I will end with this work because this is the artist that we lost most recently. In fact, Mohammed Durra from Jordan only passed away I think a month ago. So thank you to the team at the McMullen for updating the label and referencing his passing on. Mohamed Durra was one of the first modern artists in Jordan, and he is responsible for educating an entire generation of artists from Jordan. He was taught by a Russian to create figurative work, but I think that the credit goes to him that by the 1950s, he had taken a turn into abstraction on his own. And once again, he passed away just a few weeks ago. And so we are losing these artists almost on a month-to-month basis. And I think at least he knew that this exhibition had taken place. Then I went to see him in Jordan just a year ago. So I will stand here and I will take some questions if Ivana will tell us if there's any questions. And maybe I'll take some time just to explain one other thing is that this exhibition actually is taking place on two floors. There's a floor above us with many other artists like Ofemia Rizq, like Etel Adnan and Simon Fattal and so many others. However, I didn't know whether we had time to go up the flight of stairs. Perhaps if we have a question or two, Ivana, I can take them here. And if people by popular demand write on the chat to go upstairs, I'll do that. Otherwise, I can take one or two questions if you have any. Okay. And would you like us to go upstairs? Can you guys do thumbs up or something so I can know? Thumbs up? Oh my God. Okay. Let's go upstairs. So did you see this video of us here? Let's see what time it is. Okay, we've got a few minutes. So once again, I want to just remind everybody that it's impossible to cover an entire region in of two continents in a single exhibition. But one thing that we try to do is to cover some of the information that is missing in our, maybe to do a plug, in our book. And this book includes essays by some of the most important scholars of our time. Hi, Peter. Including Salah Hassan from Sudan, Nada Shabboud from Iraq, Shahila Takesh of Barjeel, and so many others who have written in this publication. We're going up. The McMullen, as you can see, is a lovely, lovely museum. Could you just take a quick shot of the snow outside? We have a beautiful garden. I really hope you guys get to visit the show. Okay, thank you. And thank you so much, Rachel, for going up the stairs without looking. So this is the other gallery, ladies and gentlemen, we're going in. Okay, thank you so much. There's Diana again. Okay, wow. Yes. So this is the other part of taking shape at the on the third floor of the McMullen Arts Museum. I think I will begin with this work by Simon Fattal. Simon Fattal, I think, is one of the most important artists of our time. She lives in Paris maybe for a number of years now, and she is now seen as an artist creating non-figurative and figurative sculpture, ceramics, and paintings, but this work titled Celestial Forms, I feel references human bodies. I'm not sure if you agree with me, but she definitely, I think, has the feel of human bodies. Again, this work for me is one of the most difficult works to acquire because it was so expensive and it was in auction. And the reason why it was very difficult to acquire is it was part of the collection of an American collector called David Rockefeller. So David Rockefeller had this work, yes, had this work in his collection. Yeah, I understand bought only two works by Middle Eastern artists in his 100-year life. Yes, and this work by Salib Edouahi, referencing a grotto in Lebanon from 1963, has a fascinating story, which you can read about in the Taking Shape book, which I urge you to read, whether in a library or order the book. And he had met a Lebanese collector in Beirut who introduced him to the work of Salib Edouahi in the early 1960s. And this is the work that he had acquired. If I can bring you here, Rachel, to one of my favorite little works. It is a painting called Autumn in Yosemite Valley by Etel Adnan. And Etel Adnan is one of the favorite artists of many, many people. Whenever I post about her, she gets the highest reaction. Etel Adnan actually was recognized mostly as a poet and an author. She had written a book in the late 1970s called Sit Mary Rose, referencing a story of a worker in Lebanon who was killed, and she wrote this book about her. And however, recently she has been rediscovered as an abstract artist. I mean, she's been doing work since the 1950s. She was born in 1925, and many of her works are smaller and are very, very now sought after. And she is seen as one of the most recognized names in modern Middle Eastern art. And she lives in Lebanon, in Paris with her partner, Simon Fattal. This work, I can tell you, this work was a very late addition, probably the very last work to be added into the show. You don't know the story. I was on a trip to Jordan in this, I think the fall of 2019. And I went to visit a friend, and I saw this work by Seta Manukyan, who is a Lebanese Armenian artist. And the town is called, the work is called Across the Town, but it's from her bedsheet series, and it dates back to 1970. And I thought this work needs to be in the show. And so we acquired it, and I proposed it, and I think the curators were happy to see it. Again, she references a time in which she was going through some reflection. She stayed in her room for long periods of time, and she started drawing her bed sheets. And so this is from that series, and it's a beautiful work, and you can almost feel the texture of the bed sheets in this work. Okay. Here you have two artists from the Gulf. On the right, you have a Qatari artist, Jassim Zaini, who studied in Iraq in the late 1960s and early 1970s. And on the left is the UAE's Najat Mekki. I like this little work called Window because she used henna to create it. And I like the fact that artists, and many of them women, were using local materials in the 1970s and 1980s. This is a little gem by Ezekiel Baruch, who was an Egyptian Jewish artist, who was also part of that group of artists who had signed a manifesto to denounce the turn to the right in Europe between the wars. And so he was an artist who had signed this manifesto. He was a figurative artist all the way until the 1940s and early 50s. This work, though, from 1955, you see, is an abstract painting. It's called Composition, and we're very happy that it is here. You know, it's important always to ask artists and try to study the story of the works, because I admit, initially, when I read Earthquake, 1967, I assumed it was a political event, and this is a painting by Ibrahim Ismail from Kuwait. However, talking to the artist, I discovered that he's referencing the earthquake, not a political earthquake, but an actual earthquake of Agadir in Morocco in 1967. It's a stunning little piece, again, shows you how things were being disheveled and the movement of the ground in 1967. However, this next one is a political work. It's abstract, but it is political, and it is by Asma Fayoumi from Syria, and she here references an event that took place and shook the Middle East and North Africa region, the 1967 war, when Israel was able to occupy large parts of the Arab world, and in Syria, it had occupied the Golan Heights. And this work, again, was created in that time, and or the aftermath of the occupation of the Golan Heights. And the title of the painting is Requiem for a City. And I feel the upper part is a reference to the city. So you see almost an urban or architectural shapes. And then, Rachel, if you slowly go down, you will see three or four faces of people that I feel are sort of hiding or cowering or not showing themselves. And I feel like this might be a reference to the tragedy that had befallen them, the shock that they were going through, waking up one day within a period of 1 week to discover that territories that belonged to their country were now occupied. And then, how are we doing on time?
12 minutes.
Okay, so maybe I'll do these two last works. Okay, so very briefly, I'll start with this one on the right. This is a work by an artist called Maliha Afnan, who was born, who was born in Haifa, Palestine in 1935. Maliha Afnan was born to Iranian migrants who were Baha'i. Again, Baha'i is a faith that you find mostly in the Middle East and North Africa, but it is all over the world today. It's called Mindscape. And what's interesting about Maliha Afnan, ladies and gentlemen, is that she started drawing letters before she started writing. So Maliha Afnan, ever since her childhood, she was creating letter forms. And this is something that stayed with her all the way in her adult life. So you can see here, it almost looks like she's referencing, and she, by the way, she spoke several languages. I understand that she understood that she spoke Hebrew and Arabic and Persian and English and French. And so multilingual artist. And again, referencing a lot of these languages, letters in her work. I will end with this, I think, one of our most important works by Munir Al-Qadhi. And this work, I'm so happy that we had acquired it at auction in 2015, I believe. Munir Al-Qadhi was born in Pune in India in 1939. And in the 1930s and 40s, many families had immigrated from the Gulf to India. My family included, but families from Bahrain, Qatar, Kuwait, Eastern Saudi Arabia, Oman, and across the UAE. Her family had moved to India, and the reason they did that, of course, is because there were more opportunities in India than the Gulf. Of course, when oil was discovered, many of these families moved back to the Gulf. Munira Al-Qadhi, her brother, I think, passed away just a few weeks ago in India, or a few months ago. Here, she references she's depicting an abstract show, an abstract artwork. However, a lot of people say that there's definitely inspirations drawn from a local context, from sexuality, from abstract geometric forms, and also reproduction. So the idea of reproduction appears in this work a number of times. I also understand that there was a piece of cloth that was part of this work that is no longer there. So we are not sure of that. I will also tell you two more things about Munira Al-Qadhi, is that when Sultan Gallery, no relation, opened in Kuwait in 1969, she was the debut artist along with an Iraqi artist. So she was being collected by Kuwaitis in the 1960s. And she was also collected by the MoMA in 1964-65. So the MoMA has one of her artworks, which I reference in my essay for the Taking Shape book. However, just one last tidbit of this work. This work was part of the collection of a Lebanese architect called Asim Salam, who bought it when she had an exhibition in Beirut, I think in 1964 or 65, and stayed with him until his passing in about 8 or 9 years ago, in which it came up to auction and we bought it. So Munir Al-Qadhi was definitely an artist who was acquired locally in Kuwait, regionally in Lebanon and elsewhere, and internationally by museums such as the MoMA. And she's still alive, knock on wood, one of the most important artists, I believe, of our time. I will stop here. Maybe I will turn around so that you have more context behind me, and I can take one or two questions before we end.
Thank you for that. As Professor Al-Qassemi noted, many artists were inspired by geography in their works. And I was wondering how this influence manifests itself today, given increasingly dire effects of climate change in the Arab world.
So artists were inspired by geography, and how they are inspired today by climate change that we are going through, of course. These artworks here stop in the 1980s, but if you're thinking of contemporary artists, yes, there are many contemporary artists from across the region who are referencing climate change, who are referencing many other issues such as human rights, women's rights, issues such as minorities' rights, freedom, democracy, LGBT issues. And so definitely climate change is, I can't think of people doing it off the top of my head, only because I'm so anxious thinking about information about this exhibition. But Max, if you reach out to me, I will send you a list of artists who work on climate change.
Two questions from Colin. It says, what was the thing you learned about abstract art in the Arab world through this process that surprised you the most? And why do you think this strand of Arab art was less well known until recently?
Okay, so what did we learn from, what did I personally learn from putting this collection and this show together? And what was the second half?
What, why do you think this strand of Arab art was less known until recently? So they're asking what you learned about abstract art in the Arab world.
Okay. So I think why was, I'll begin with the second half of the question. So why was abstract art not really studied very much? Well, the reality is so much art is not studied. So there aren't any studies about certain minorities, Armenians of the Arab world or Jews of the Arab world. There aren't many studies about movements of the Arab world. There's no study about circulism in Kuwait. There's no study about, so you're really missing out on so much. And so what I tell my students here at Boston College and other universities is that we are participating in the writing of the canon of modern Middle Eastern art history. And I remember one of my students had written the first ever biography of an Egyptian artist called Zainab Abdelhamid. And there was nothing about her online, I think one or two lines. And so this article that my student had written had gone up on the internet, and now it is the source of information about her. And so this is an opportunity for people around the world to populate Wikipedia, to populate blogs, to populate Twitter and Instagram, but not disappearing stories, to populate social media and the internet and books and papers. And one thing we try to do here, Ivana, is publish books. So what Barjeel has done over the past 10 years is published 16 books, and many of these essays are available, some of which are available free online on our website, and some you have to acquire because of certain rights. And so the writing of the canon of West Asian, South Asian, and African art is still a work in progress. And this is why you don't have much information. And one other thing is there was an attempt by a group in Lebanon, led by Saleh Barakat, of Ajial Art Gallery, to put together an exhibition and a book of abstract Arab art, I think about a decade ago. It didn't materialize for a number of reasons, but there was an attempt, and the text was available, and they kindly shared it with me, so I'm very grateful for that opportunity. What I discovered, well, I said earlier, I discovered how important women were in the abstract art movement. There's 90 works on display here, And I remember the first time I visited our permanent display in Sharjah when the works left, I just felt like the collection was diminished. I just felt like part of the soul of the collection was taken out. Our Etel Adnan, our Salwa Rada Shukair, our Samia Halabi works, all these works by women were taken out of the exhibition to go on this tour of United States university museums. So I think discovering how important women are. And another thing, Ivana, is discovering how political abstract art is. Because initially, for me, when I looked at abstract art, I thought, well, it kind of looks like interesting shapes, but is it really relevant to the political movement? And I discovered that, yes, the reason is, again, as I referenced in the beginning of this tour, it was created at a time of nation building. It was created at a time of identity politics. It was created at a time of rejecting Western influence in Middle Eastern and North African art. It was created at a time of global tension between the Soviet bloc and the United States-led bloc. And so many of these artists decided to be somewhere in the middle alongside the non-aligned movement. And so it is quite more political than I thought. Is there any other question? Do I anticipate an artistic exchange? I don't work for the government. I can't answer that question. But obviously, there's many avenues that the UAE seems to be interested in cooperating with Israel. But I am a scholar. I am a teacher. I cannot speak on behalf of any government. But thank you for the question.
And there's another question from Alex. If you could choose one artwork by non-Arab world artists to include in the show, what would it be and why?
Oh, there's so many. I think the Arab world sits in a part of the world that's influenced by many other regions, whether you're talking about Iran, for example. I would think of Armenian-Iranian artist Marcos Grigorian, who created work using, local material. Or I would think of the artist Fakhrinnisa, who is a Turkish artist. I would think of artists who came from Ethiopia or from sub-Saharan Africa. So there are many, many artists from across the outside the Arab world, from the territories surrounding the Arab world that played an important role, South Asian. Oh my God, there's so many. Again, one thing I want to say here is The purpose, of course, is not to box Arab art into a separate criteria. The reality is that there are artists here who descend from Turkish descent, and they're Jewish, as I said, they're Armenian, they're from all over. But what they had in common, at least in this show, is they all carried an Arab passport. They all carried a passport from one of the Arab states. They're not all ethnically Arab. Many of them are ethnically Persian, they're Jewish, they're Armenian. So they're not ethnically Arab, but they carried a passport of the Arab state. And I try to draw a comparison of doing an exhibition of USSR artists. If you did an exhibition of USSR artists, many of them would be Georgian or Armenian or Kazakh or Lithuanian. Are they Russian ethnically? No, but they belonged to this Soviet, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. So this is the way I look at it sometimes.
There's one last question. Is the abstract movement your favorite Arab art movement?
Oh my God, how can I answer that? Well, let me put it this way. I appreciate it much more today. I do not think it's my favorite, but I appreciate it much more than I did, just saying a lot. My favorite is, and again, I teach a class here at Boston College called Politics of Modern Middle Eastern Art. And so I will look at monuments, at sculpture, at paintings and figurative works. We look at songs and poetry and national anthems. And so abstract art is kind of difficult to argue extensively in a classroom. However, I must say that I'm very, very proud of my students at Boston College, who just on Tuesday, where we held a class on abstract art, really, I think, rose to the challenge and were able to argue the politics behind abstract art. I was in awe in my own classroom. Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming. Wow. Well, thank you. I'm actually still overwhelmed. Thank you to Diana. Thank you to Ivana. Thank you to Rachel. Thank you to Peter, who was keeping us here safe. Thank you to the McMullen Museum. Thank you all for joining us, and make sure that you visit every Friday the docents tour. And
actually, on Wednesday, we have a publication highlight by Alex
Dika-Segerman. Oh, great. Yes, so don't miss the highlight by Alex Dika-Segerman, one of the most important scholars. Everything's on the McMullen website, so make sure you visit and register. Thank you very much.